Okay, in today's lecture, we'll discuss the proof of the fact that any rectangular matrix can be made row equivalent to a row reduced echelon matrix. Okay, this is one of the important results in linear equations. So we'll prove this result and look at other consequences. Let me first recall the definition of a row reduced echelon matrix. So let's say R, a rectangular matrix with real entries m rows and n columns, is called row reduced. Is called a row reduced echelon matrix. Is called a row reduced echelon matrix if it satisfies the following conditions. The first condition is that the leading non-zero entry of each non-zero row of R, the leading non-zero entry of each non-zero row of R is 1. That is the first non-zero entry in each non-zero row of R is 1. This is the first condition. Second condition, look at each column. Look at each column corresponding to the leading non-zero entry of a non-zero row. All the other entries along this column must be 0. This is the second condition. So the statement is each column corresponding to the leading non-zero entry, which is 1. Okay, so look at each column corresponding to the leading non-zero entry of each non-zero row of R has all its other entries 0. Has all its other entries 0. This is the second condition. Okay, so look at the columns which have the leading non-zero entry of a non-zero row of R. The entry, all the other entries except this leading non-zero entry must be 0. This is the second condition. We also have three more conditions. So let me go to the other conditions. Each zero row of R occurs below every non-zero row of R. And I said that this is like stacking the zero rows of R at the bottom. Condition 4. If I equals 1, 2, 3, etc. are the non-zero rows of R, and if the leading non-zero entry occurs in a column leading non-zero entry, I think I need to make a slight change. The leading non-zero entry of row I, okay, that occurs in a column Ci, I equals 1, 2, 3, etc. R, then we require that C1 less than C2, etc. less than CR.
Okay, so these are the conditions that a row reduced echelon matrix must satisfy. Okay. Okay, this we had seen yesterday. What I would like to do today is to discuss how every matrix can be reduced to a row reduced echelon matrix. See, this is important. How every matrix can be reduced to a row reduced echelon matrix. That's what I'm going to discuss today, and also discuss some of the properties of row reduced echelon matrices. Okay, okay. But before proceeding, let's look at one or two examples. I have given a few yesterday. Let me give you a couple of examples today. Identity matrix of any order. Okay, of any order. This is a row reduced echelon matrix, trivially. Let me give you one more example, which we will also use a little later. The matrix, I'll call it R. R will hereafter stand for row reduced echelon matrix. Let's say I have something like this. Okay, 3 rows, 5 columns. This is another example of a row reduced echelon matrix. Okay, there is also another fact which we will need a little later. You think over this question. I will pose this as a problem. Suppose that R is a square row reduced echelon matrix. With the property that the number of non-zero rows, okay, with the property that the number of non-zero rows R equals the order of the matrix. I have a square row reduced echelon matrix with the property that the number of non-zero rows is equal to the order of the matrix. Okay, what can you say about R? Just think it over. Okay, we'll come back and answer this question a little later. Okay, okay. As I mentioned, it's important to note that every matrix can be reduced to a row reduced echelon matrix. Okay, so let me prove that now. Okay, so what I'll discuss next is the following theorem and its proof. Just change this. I will simply say every is row equal. Okay. Now that is a statement of a theorem, so I would like to put it this way. Any matrix is row equivalent to a row reduced echelon matrix. Okay. By the way, the reason why we need to reduce a matrix to a row reduced echelon form is that row reduced echelon form is a much simpler matrix to handle than the original matrix A. Okay, you will see that a little later if you have not already seen it. Remember that we are looking at the system AX equal to B, that system 1, we have reduced it to a system of the form Cx equal to D, and we are looking at a particular structure for C. Okay, it is really this structure that we are seeking. We are seeking C to be a row reduced echelon matrix. So we must know that every matrix can be reduced to a row reduced echelon matrix. That's what we are going to prove now. Okay, so proof. Let me write down the matrix A with its entries Aij as follows: A11, A12, A13, etc., A1n, m rows n columns, A21, A22, A23, etc., AM1, AM2, etc., AMN. Okay, I want to do elementary row operations on this matrix and reduce it to a row reduced echelon matrix. Okay, we will handle this matrix row by row. Let's look at the first row. If all the entries of the first row are 0, then I'll go to the second row. If all the entries of the second row are 0, I'll go to the third row, and so on. Okay, so one possibility is that A is 0. That is trivially a row reduced echelon matrix. Okay, suppose A is not 0, and suppose the first row is not the 0 row. Okay, there is some non-zero entry. Let's take the first one, the first non-zero entry when you go from left to right, the first non-zero entry when you go from left to right in the first row. So I'll call that as A1k. Let A1k be non-zero. And what is the property of k? K is the least. With k being the least among the non-zero entries in the first row. Among the non-zero entries, I am looking at Aik. A1k, k is the least. A1k is not 0, okay, which means to the left of A1k all entries are 0. Okay, so how does a matrix A look like? With this information, the matrix A looks as follows. The first k minus 1 entries are 0. This entry is non-zero, that is A1k. The other entries are there as it is. The other rows, I won't disturb them now. So they are left as they are. I know that A1k is not 0, so I will do this first elementary row operation. See, what I want is that the leading non-zero entry of each row is 1. I know that this A1k is not 0, so I will do this first operation. Obviously, look at 1 by A1k of the first row. Okay, that is the first operation. Upon this operation, this is an elementary row operation. Okay, then A is row equivalent to this matrix. All the entries to the left of A1k, okay, they are all 0. The entry for A1k that has been replaced by 1. All other entries I will use a star to denote them. The other entries are left as they are right now. Okay, that is the first step. Next step. Remember the condition that must be satisfied by a row reduced echelon matrix, the second condition. Each column that has a leading non-zero entry has corresponding to some row has all other entries 0, which means I must make these entries 0. I must make the entries of the kth column of A below this 1 to be 0, but I know how to do it. So that is that tells me what the next set of operations must be. Look at row 2. The new row 2 will be, see, this entry is A2k, okay, etc. This entry is AMK, entries in the kth column. So I do these operations simultaneously. Row 2 has been replaced by minus A2k row 1 plus row 2, etc. Row m has been replaced by minus AMK row 1 plus row m. Okay, do this one after the other. then the matrix A reduces to the following form. A is row equivalent to this matrix 0 0 etc 0, this entry A1k originally that was 1, leave the other entries of the first row as they are. Now these entries I do not know what they are, okay. This particular entry is 0, that much I know. These entries also, they may be 0, they may be non-zero, but right now I am not concerned. Let me fill up the first, the column corresponding to k, that is the kth column of the original matrix A. Now if you look at the entries in this kth column, they are 1 0 0 0, okay. The first entry is 1, all the other entries are 0, and again these entries may be 0, non-zero, I am not concerned presently, okay. So the first two conditions of a row reduced to echelon matrix are satisfied for the first row at this stage, okay. The first, the leading non-zero entry of the first row is 1, each column containing the first column, the column that contains the leading non-zero entry of the first row, that is the kth column, has all its other entries 0, okay. Now we are in two cases when I look at the second row. Let me write down the matrix. If all the entries of the second row are 0, I do nothing to the second row, okay, presently. If all the entries of the second row are 0, I do nothing to the second row, I move to the third row. If all the entries of the third row are 0, I do nothing, I proceed like that. If there is some entry of the second row which is non-zero, then there is one thing for sure, this cannot occur in the kth column. If there is a non-zero entry in the second row, that non-zero entry cannot occur in the kth column, because kth column has been taken care of. Let me use this to denote the kth column. Kth column, all the entries except the first row entry are 0, so the non-zero entry in the second row cannot be in the kth column, okay. So it is either to the left of the kth column or to the right of the kth column. I will consider these two cases separately, okay. So let me introduce two arrows to denote the two possibilities. One happens somewhere here, okay. This corresponds to the left of column k, okay. I will call that p, column p. This happens in column p, p less than k. Okay, this is one possibility. The other possibility is to the right, that is the leading non-zero entry of the second row, that is what I am looking at, that either happens to the left of the kth column or to the right of the kth column. It cannot be the kth column, that is clear now. So let us say this entry corresponds to the leading non-zero entry, so I will call it to the right of column k. I will call that q, column q, q greater than k. P or Q cannot be equal to K, that is clear. So let us take these two cases separately and then see how this can be handled. Let us take the case on the right, okay. So let me write down this matrix once again. A is row equivalent to this matrix. The other entries, I leave them as they are. I know that these are 0 below 1. So this is the case we are in. This is non-zero, okay. That is, this corresponds to A2, I am calling that as Q. A2Q is non-zero, okay. Leading non-zero entry, Q is the least among the second subscripts. Leading non-zero entry of row 2. Q is the least among the second subscripts. Q is the least among the second subscripts occurring in the second row. Second row is, we started with A21, A22, etc., A2n, they have not changed except A2k, okay. So among these, I take the one which is the first non-zero entry. So I am call, that is A2Q. I know that that is not 0, So what is the next operation? I will divide this second row by this number. So the second row is replaced by 1 by A2Q times row 2, okay, so that this entry becomes 1. Remember, I am looking at the leading non-zero entry of the second row. I am looking at the leading non-zero entry of the second row, okay. So this gives me the following matrix: 0, 0, etc., 1. The entries along this column are 0 except the first one. These remain the same. The second row now changes. I do not, okay, the second row changes. I know for certain that these entries are 0. This is also 0. Let me use the same picture here. This entry is 1. All the entries, other entries I am not concerned, but I know for sure that these entries to the left of 1 are 0 because of the definition of A2Q. A2Q is the first non-zero entry in the second row. So first non-zero entry in second row, which means all the other entries before that entry in the second row are 0, okay. Okay, then the rest of them are kept as they are presently. Then we do, we need to do elementary row operations now using the second row, okay. We need to do elementary row operations using the second row. So what are these operations? Okay, that's clear. We need to change the first row also because I must make this entry 0. This entry must also be made 0, okay. Only then the condition of the second condition corresponding to row reduced echelon matrix will be satisfied corresponding to this leading non-zero entry of the second row, okay. So I do these operations. Row 1 is, see this entry is 1 and see this entry is as it is the original entry. So this is A1Q, right. So I look at 1, I am sorry, I look at minus A1Q times row 2 plus row 1. I do a similar thing for all the other rows. Row 2 remains the same. Row 3 is minus this entry A3Q row 3 plus row 1 etc. row m minus AMQ row m plus row 1. Yes.
Is A1Q divided by
A1K. Okay. Yes, you are right. A1Q divided by A1K. Yes. This is A1Q divided by A1K. All right. Yes, we are doing the first operation is, yes, that's correct. First row has been replaced by the row divided by A1K, the first non-zero entry of, yes, that's correct. So this is A1Q by A1K, that is not 0. I want to make that entry 0, so I do these operations, okay. I do these operations, then A reduces to the following matrix. All these entries are 0. This entry is 0 now, okay, corresponding to this. So let's say I put a star and then put a 0, leave the other entries. I am not concerned about the other entries rather. Then all these entries are 0, 1 occurs here, this must be 0. Other entries I am not concerned. What I also know is that these entries now become 0. So first this column, next this column. Not concerned about the other rows presently. Yes. This is
into R2.
The pivot row is the second row. Yes. This must be R3. This must be Rm. Yes. The pivot row is R2. I am keeping R2 as the row with respect to which I do the other, with respect to which I change the entries. of the matrix. Yes. So this is what happens when the leading non-zero entry of the second row is to the right of column K. That is, it happens in column Q. Q is greater than K. Okay. I need to look at the other case, and then we'll proceed by induction. Okay. What is the other case? Let me start all over from here. The second case corresponds to the leading non-zero entry being present here. Okay. This is A2P. Okay, that's A2P according to my notation. P is not K, and P is the least. P is the least among the second subscripts of the second row, entries of the second row. P is the least among the second subscripts of the entries of the second row. So now it is to the left of K. So I again do the same operation, a similar operation. Row 2 has been replaced, will be replaced now by 1 by A2P. Row 2, okay. That will give me a 1, that will give me a 1 here. So A is equivalent to, okay, this is column K. These entries I am not, I will not be concerned now. This is the first non-zero entry, so these two entries are 0. I have 1 here. These are certain other entries. These are not changed. Is that okay? So now I do, now this is to the left of the kth column, so I will not disturb the first row, unlike what I did earlier. Earlier it was to the right of the kth column, and so I need to change this particular entry to make it 0. Okay, but now it is to the left of this column. The one, the leading non-zero entry of the second row is to the left of the column K, and so these entries I know are already 0, so I do not touch row 1 now. Okay, I do the elementary row operations corresponding to row 3, etc., row m, using this second row to get the following matrix. Okay, so I am looking at row 2 has been, row 1 has been fixed, I do not change that now. Row 2 has been fixed, row 3, etc. Row 3, for instance, I must look at this entry, that is minus A3Q, I am sorry, A3P, minus A3P times row 2 plus row 3. Minus A3P times row 2 plus row 3, that is row 3, etc. Row m is minus AMP row 2. Row 2 has been used as so called pivot row. AMP row 2 plus row m to get the following matrix as a row reduced, rather the following matrix as a row equivalent matrix, row equivalent to A. First row entries, they are 0, 1 here, these entries are 0. First row entries are not disturbed. I have a 1 occurring here, 0, 0, 1. This entry is 0, this is already 0, let us note that this is already 0. These entries have been made 0 now because of these operations. These entries have been made 0. So this is now corresponding, this corresponding to the second row, the leading non-zero entry appears in column P, and I observe that the second condition is satisfied. All the other entries are 0. Okay, now what is to be observed is the following. When the leading non-zero entry occurs to the right of the column K, okay, what we have observed is that the entries corresponding to the first row before the leading non-zero entry, they are not changed. any case, we are is that okay? If the leading non-zero entry of the second row occurs to the right of column K or to the left of column K, the entries of the first row before 1 including 1, those entries are not changed, nor are the entries corresponding to the kth column under the entry 1, they are not changed in any case, okay. So you are to the right of K or to the left of K, these entries do not change. So by induction, one can show that these entries do not change when you do these elementary row operations, okay. We proceed by induction, go to the third row. The third row, if it is full of zeros, all zeros, then go to the fourth row, etc. If third row has a leading non-zero entry, then do the same operation again. And since there are n operation, since there are m rows, this procedure stops after you are done with the last row, mth row, okay. So this is a finite procedure. In the last step, you get a row reduced echelon matrix. So I will simply say by induction, A is row equivalent to a row reduced echelon matrix. Yes.
In case two,
we have to interchange. C1 less than C2, less than C3. Yo, I have not mentioned that, but then the proof is not complete. Let me just include the following. I'll tell you orally. It is still not row equivalent to a row reduced echelon matrix. I need to look at these C1, C2, etc. Right, and I also need to stack them in such a way that the 0 rows are at the bottom, okay, but that can be done by row interchanges, okay. So that does not need much explanation at all. That is, what is the third condition? Third condition is every 0 row must happen, must occur below every non-zero row, and that can be done by row interchanges, okay. What is the last condition? I have the first r non-zero rows, and I have the leading non-zero entries occurring in column C1, C2, etc., CR. These must be arranged in such a way that C1 less than C2, etc., less than CR, okay. But this can again be done by row interchanges. And so I get in the final step, I get the row reduced echelon matrix R after doing these row interchanges if necessary, okay. So let's consolidate by looking at a numerical example. I'll take the row reduced echelon matrix that I had given at the beginning of the lecture. I want to look at all the solutions of the system Rx equal to 0, where R is given by this matrix. Please tell me if the entries are all right. 0, 1, 0, 4, this entry is 2. What is this entry? 4, 0, half, 0, 0, 0, 1, 5, and the last row is 0. This is a row reduced echelon matrix. The leading non-zero entry of each row is 1. Each column containing the leading non-zero entry of any row has all its other entries 0. Non-zero rows are stacked above the 0 rows. So this is a row reduced echelon matrix. I want to look at the set of all solutions of the system Rx equal to 0, homogeneous presently. Rx equal to 0 is the same as, if you expand, you get the following equation. This is x2, x2 plus 4x3 plus 1 by 2x5, that is 0, first equation. Second equation is, this is x4, x4 plus 5x5. Is 0. The last row is 0, so it does not impose any condition on the unknowns x1, x2, etc., x5. Okay. So what I do now is, what is clear is that x1 is arbitrary. X1 is arbitrary. X5 can also be chosen to be arbitrary. All the other unknowns can be determined. There are 5 variables, essentially 2 equations. I need to fix 3. So x1 is arbitrary. I will call it alpha. X5 is arbitrary, but before that I will also observe that x3 can be chosen to be arbitrary. Either x3 or x2. Let us say I choose x2. I will call that beta. X2 is also arbitrary. Finally, x5 is arbitrary. X5 can be chosen as any real number. So I will call that gamma. Then with these choices for x1, x2, x5, I can determine x2 and x4 uniquely. For this choice, I can determine x2 and x4 uniquely. So x2 turns out to be what? Minus 1 by 2 x5 minus 1 by 2 gamma minus 4 x3. Yes, x2 is beta, I want x3. X3 is 1 by 4 times, okay, let me write this, okay. I am looking at the first equation. 1 by 4 times minus 1 by 2 gamma. That is this term minus x2 minus beta, that is x3 for me, okay. Please check the calculations. And x4, x4 is minus 5 x5 minus 5 gamma, okay. You substitute x1, x2, x3, x4, x5 into the 2 equations, verify that they are satisfied. So I will write down the set of all solutions of the system Rx equal to 0. In this example, I will call that S. It is the set of all x1, x2, x3, x4, x5. X1 is alpha, x2 is beta, x3 is 1 by 4, so I will write it as it, okay. I can take minus, minus 1 by 4, minus 1 by 4, minus 1, sorry, half gamma plus beta, that is the third component. The fourth component is x4 minus 5 gamma, the fifth component has been fixed to be gamma. Alpha, beta, gamma are arbitrary real numbers. So this tells us immediately that there are infinitely many solutions. I can rewrite it, but I leave it as it is. Yeah, I must close this. This is the set of all solutions, okay, for this homogeneous system. Okay, let us now look at some of the other properties of a row reduced echelon matrix. Okay, but before that, using this numerical example as a motivating example, let us also look at the general case, okay, which is R is a row reduced echelon matrix. I want to look at the system Rx equal to 0, okay. To formalize what I have done for this numerical example, R is a row reduced echelon matrix. I want to look at the set of all solutions of Rx equal to 0, okay. Let us, the original variables are the original unknowns are x1, x2, etc., xn. I need to relabel them. Let us say that I equal to 1, 2, 3, etc. are the non-zero rows of R. R is a row reduced echelon matrix. The non-zero rows are at the top. I am assuming that they are R in number. I also have these numbers C1, C2, C3, etc. Okay, etc. CR are the columns corresponding to the leading non-zero entries of the rows 1, 2, 3, etc. R. Okay, I am just confirming that this is a notation we have adopted. We also know that C1 less than C2, etc. less than CR. Let me now relabel the unknowns as those that correspond to the non-zero rows and those that do not. Relabel the unknowns as the rows that correspond to the non-zero rows. Those that correspond to the non-zero rows, I will denote them naturally by XC1, XC2, etc. XCR. I am relabeling the unknowns that we started with x1, etc., xn, xc1, xc2, etc., xcr naturally correspond to the unknowns with respect to the non-zero first r non-zero rows of R, capital R. The remaining will be named, the remaining variables or unknowns will be denoted by V1, V2, etc., V and minus R. The remaining variables will be denoted V1, V2, etc., V and minus R. So there are R corresponding to the non-zero rows and there are N minus R that correspond to the other rows. See, I am looking at the number of variables. Then can you see immediately that Rx equal to 0 is precisely the following? Let me write that here. Rx equal to 0 written in full gives me the following: XC1 plus summation j equals 1 to n minus r. Let me say I have something like alpha 1 j vj equal to 0. That is the first row. Second row, XC2 summation j equals 1 to n minus r. Second row, so I will call them alpha 2 j vj equal to 0, etc. XCr plus summation j equal to 1 to n minus r. Alpha mj, there are m equations. This is rj, I am sorry. Alpha rj vj equal to 0. These are the equations corresponding to the first non-zero, first r non-zero rows of capital R. The other equations do not appear. They do not impose any condition on the unknowns because they correspond to 0 rows. Okay. So what this says is that you can fix these variables assigning arbitrary values to V1, V2, etc., Vn minus R. The values of XC1, XC2, etc., XCR can be obtained. You assign arbitrary values to the so called free variables. Okay, these are called the free variables V1, V2, etc., Vn minus R, n minus R of them. You can determine the other R variables XC1, XC2, etc., XCR using these equations. by assigning arbitrary values to these n minus r variables. Okay, that's what we have done in the previous problem. In particular, we have the following. In particular, if r is less than n, okay, in particular, if the number of non-zero rows of capital R is less than the number of unknowns, okay, what this means is that there is at least one of these variables v1 etc. v n minus r. Okay, n minus r is positive, that means I have at least v1, at least one free variable. Okay, let me say I assign one of them the value 1. In particular, if r is less than 1, by assigning 1 of v1, v2, etc., v, n minus r, the value 1, I pick any of these n minus r variables, I pick one of them, give the value 1 to that variable, and I can assign arbitrary values to the other variables. And arbitrary values to the other n minus r minus 1 variables. By doing this, we get a non-zero, it is called a non-trivial solution. We get a non-zero solution for the system Rx equal to 0. Okay, this is an important observation. If the number of non-zero rows of the row reduced echelon matrix capital R is strictly less than the number of unknowns appearing in the problem, then the homogeneous system Rx equal to 0 has at least one non-zero solution. Do you agree? Okay, I have given the proof here. Pick one of the free variables, assign the value 1. You know that there is at least one free variable because r is less than n. Okay. Now this leads to a fundamental theorem that if you have a rectangular system of homogeneous equations with the number of equations being strictly less than the number of unknowns, then it always has a non-trivial solution. Okay, that I will prove in the next class, and also discuss other properties of row reduced echelon matrices.